Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this beautiful July morning. And so glad to be with you again today. We're looking forward to a good time of worship together and a good time of study in the Word. We're going to be talking about Jesus's teaching about prayer this morning. So we're looking forward to that. We'll be in a couple of passages out of the book of Luke. Let's go ahead and pray together this morning. There's been a few of our folks who have been in the hospital this morning. The whole Laughlin family had different things that they were getting checked out today, as well as others. So let's be in prayer for those who have needed health care and during this time when health care has been a little bit tricky to figure out and get all that we need. So let's be praying for one another. Would you join me in prayer, and then we'll go to our time of announcements. Lord, thank you for this day that you've given us. Thank you for the opportunity to gather together once again in this unique way. We look forward to the time that we can get back together in person. We long for that direct communication and the fellowship all together. But Lord, we thank you for this way that you have provided for us in the meantime. Thank you for each one who has given phone calls and looked out to the good of their neighbor during this time. Thank you for the beautiful sunshine outside and the way that you continue to bless. Lord, I know that many have needs. They have financial needs. They have desires to get back to work. Some are still out of work. Some have physical needs because of health issues and things going on in their lives. Lord, thank you that you are present, that we can lean on you and depend and trust you. Lord, I also pray that you would help us to be more aware of one another and pay better attention. I think of myself, Lord, that Lord, help me to do a better job of showing care and reaching out to others around me. Thank you for the opportunity to serve one another, not just within the body, but within our communities. And I pray that you would make us a blessing in this world in a time when it seems like so many are shrinking back from each other and only looking towards divisions and things that would hurt one another. God, I pray that we would take no part in that, but that we would look to encourage and strengthen and bless and lift other people up. God, thank you that you give us a love that is not of our own making, but is a gift from your Spirit as we serve you. Lord, help us to love out of that reservoir in your way. We thank you for the study this morning, God, and I pray that you would open our hearts and minds to receive and walk in the way that you have provided for us. Thank you, Lord, for this day. In your name, amen. Well, let's go over to our announcement time with Wendy this morning.
Good morning. Welcome to our live weekly streaming worship service. Tremont is working on plans for reopening. We are waiting to see when Multnomah County will enter into phase 2. We are going to need help, both to get our building ready, but also with the additional procedures that will be in place weekly, like extra cleaning and making masks and sanitizers available for those who choose to attend. If you would be willing to help, please contact Pastor Nathan. We are planning to have our first youth meeting on Wednesday, July 22nd at 7 p.m. We do ask that students who attend plan to wear masks and adhere to social distancing guidelines during youth group. We also ask that parents be prompt about picking their students up at 8:30 p.m. If you are in need of food, you can visit our food pantry on Knight Street behind the main building. They are open on Mondays at 8:30 a.m. If you would like to support our food pantry, we accept donations of non-perishable food or bottles and cans. Please contact the church office to arrange a drop-off time. If you would like to join us on Zoom for our weekly prayer meetings, please contact Edwin Carbo or the church office to request the link and password. Meetings are on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. If you would like to receive our weekly bulletin, which has all of our latest updates, as well as upcoming sermon information, please email tremontchurch@gmail.com and ask to be put on the bulletin list. Check out our website for the latest videos, announcements, and recommendations at tremontchurch.com or on facebook.com/tremontchurchpdx.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to our time of worship where we come in together and we sing songs of praise and worship to our Heavenly Father. Join us as we sing the first song, which is called Your Name.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth. You touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. It's a shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Jesus, in your name we pray. Come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name. Singing louder, cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Strong and mighty tower, your name is a shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, cause nothing has the power to save. Your name is a strong and mighty tower, your name is a shelter like no other. Sing it louder, cause nothing has the power to say but your name.
This next song is called Change My Heart, O God.
Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God,
heart.
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be thine. You are the
song is What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to so faithful, who will all our sorrows share. Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. And are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still our
verse 1.
And what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often of our way. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, early let us turn to thee, and early let us seek thy favor, early let us do thy will. Blessed Lord and only Savior, with thy love our bosoms fill. Blessed Jesus, Jesus, thou hast loved us, love us still.
All right. Song we're going to do is one of my favorites. It's called Seek Ye First.
Yeah.
Thank you for joining us for our time of worship. And now let's go back to Pastor Nathan.
Well, thank you, everyone, for joining us for a time of worship together. I really appreciate those songs that we got to sing together. I don't know how you're doing it in your household. In the couple of times that I've gotten to be with my household on Sundays, we've enjoyed singing the songs together. Maybe in your household you're timid to do that, or maybe you're just belting them out as loud as you can. Either way, I hope they bless your heart and direct your mind to really meditate on the Lord and pray and to seek Him. Speaking of that, that's what we're going to be talking about this morning, is prayer. So simple title to the message today is How to Pray. Now, when I say that, this is not intended, nor is it going to be an exhaustive treatment of the topic of prayer. Many, many, many books, many scholarly approaches, many bits of wisdom have been shared over the years on prayer. Great leaders of the faith expressing what prayer has meant to them and what they have learned and experienced through prayer, as well as folks trying to understand the nature of prayer. So many different approaches have taken place. I'm sure that you have probably heard sermons and thought about and just been bombarded with many ideas around the topic of prayer. And this morning, it would be tempting, but I am not going to take a lot of time on debunking misconceptions about prayer, although there is a time and a place, and that is certainly appropriate to do, because there are many misunderstandings about prayer. But that's not where we're headed today. Today, we're going to look at two primary passages, both out of the book of Luke. Our first one is going to be from the book, from Luke chapter 11, and that's really going to be what most of us know as the Sermon on the Mount, and then also a teaching analogy that Jesus uses just after that. And then we're going to go take a look at a short parable that Jesus uses to teach about prayer in Luke chapter 18. So we'll be in those two locations this morning. And we've got three main principles or three main points that we're going to be absorbing or gleaning from these passages. And those are three instructions of how we should be praying. The first one being that we should be praying with dependence on God, then praying with faith in God, and finally praying with persistence to God. So those are going to be our three main principles that we'll be gleaning this morning through these passages. Let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll look to the Word for our first section here and see what God has for us. Let's pray. God, thank you for this time, this opportunity. Thank you for this incredible gift that you have given us of being able to communicate with your Spirit, that you are so gracious and so humble that you allow us to enter into your presence, to to let off steam, to share with you our fears and our questions and our doubts, as well as to celebrate with you and to give you praise and thanksgiving and share with you our joys and what's going on deep inside of our souls. And Lord, thank you that you are willing to listen to our requests and our burdens, what weighs us down and what we long for and hunger for. Thank you that you are so close to us and that you care so much that you've created this pathway of communication. Help us to understand it a bit more today. Help us to be appropriately bold where you've invited us to be bold, and help us to be humble and reliant on you and trusting of you where you have called us to be so. God, thank you that you are a good father. Some of us struggle with what that means. And so, God, thank you that you have demonstrated yourself and have proven your goodness over time. And help us to really trust your goodness in this area of prayer, that you will make good on your promises, that you care for us, and that you are looking for our best interests, which may not be what we want it to be. Thank you, God. You are good. Help us to understand this morning. Amen. Well, if you would, go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 11, and we're going to be starting right at the beginning of Luke chapter 11. And we're going to look at two different sections here. The first one, which will probably be the most familiar to most of us, is the first, four verses here in Luke chapter 11. And then we're going to skip down a bit to verse 9 and read verses 9 through 13 for our second point. So verses 1 through 4 of Luke 11 for our first point. And our first point is that we are to pray with dependence on God. Now, before we get there, I want to start off this morning with our Christ connection, because I thought that this was worded so well. It says this: Jesus taught us to pray with dependence on God, recognizing our physical and spiritual needs that only He can supply. With faith in God, knowing He is our good and loving Father, and with persistence to God, remembering He is just. It is through the death and resurrection of Jesus that we have access to the Father so that we can pray in faith. We've been given this incredible access to pray, and numerous times in Scripture, we are either instructed to pray or instructed to pray at a certain time or in a certain way, or there are many passages that simply assume that God's people will be engaged with prayer. We will be communicating and communing with our Heavenly Father. And we see the example with Jesus Christ of Him regularly taking times, even separating Himself from good activities, good works that He's doing, to have a time of prayer, have a time of solitude, have a time of quietness with the Father. I'm certainly reminded of just before Jesus is ushered away to the cross, that Jesus is spending the early morning hours up on that park in the Mount of Olives, spending time earnestly praying to the Lord, wrestling with the stress and the, I don't know if Jesus experienced anxiety, but the emotions and the weight, the magnitude, the gravity of what He was about to undergo on behalf of the whole world heading to the cross. We see Him there praying and even calling His close friends to come alongside and to be praying for Him and praying with Him. Well, let's go ahead and look at our first passage in Luke chapter 11, verses 1 through 4. We read, "It happened that while Jesus was praying in a certain place, after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, 'Lord, teach us to pray, just as John also taught his disciples.' And he said to them, 'When you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation.'" Now, some of you, as I read that, it sounds different than you're used to, and there's probably a couple of different things playing into that if that is your experience. One is many of us have memorized this this passage or this prayer particularly in a different translation. So usually something like the King James or a translation like that is far more commonly used at funerals, at worship services, in church settings. And so maybe that's part of your experience of why it sounds different. Now the other is, in today's lesson, we're reading the account out of the book of Luke, and I suspect many people, maybe even most people, have probably learned a slightly longer version of this prayer, which is from the account found in Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 15 has that slightly more worded account of the Lord's Prayer. Well, here we go. We have this passage, and there's a few key points that we want to draw out of this, a few key observations all around this central idea that Jesus is teaching us to pray with dependence on God, really relying on Him, trusting Him, if you would. The first principle that I want to draw out here, out of verses... the second part of verse 2 in particular, is that Jesus starts off this prayer and he gives a call for us to acknowledge God's glory and his holiness. His disciples, we're told here, have observed him praying. We know that they have seen him, they have observed him pray as their rabbi, as their leader, their teacher, numerous times before. And on this particular occasion, he's been praying, and at least one of them speaks up and says, makes a request and says, "Lord," or "teacher," "master, teach us to pray like John the Baptist did for his disciples." So evidently, there were times when John the Baptist had given some training to those who were following him and learning from him, specifically on prayer and what it means or what they could do, how they could engage with the Lord through prayer. And these disciples are asking for that too. Now that fits really, really well with our understanding of the relationship and what it meant in that day to be a disciple. Their whole reason for being around him from the cultural perspective was that he was the learned one, the more seasoned one, the one who had wrestled with more ideas or had a deeper relationship with the Lord. Pardon me a second. And in their desire and in their calling from him as the master to glean, to learn, to pick up these habits and these beliefs and these disciplines of faith, a big part of that was learning what were the disciplines that this individual, this master, used to draw close to God, to understand, to glean the truth. And a huge part of that spiritually is prayer, to communicate with God. So it makes absolute sense that while observing, that one of the disciples would say, Lord, would you give us some tips? Would you give us an inside understanding of what's going through your mind? What principles to use? What is your habit of prayer? We see how often you pray. We observe many things from the outside, but would you give us some inside understanding? Jesus then starts that off with this first principle of acknowledging God's glory and his holiness. Let me read that one more time out of verse 2 there. He says, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed or holy is your name or be your name. Your kingdom come. This has the idea of a couple of things. One, it is using the language of holiness. Hallowed is your name. It is set apart. You are, your nature, your character, Lord, is different. It is above. It is holy. It is separated off. It is pure in nature, is the claim here. And then your kingdom come. Perhaps you're wondering where I got the term glory from. The idea here, or the language, is kingdom language. And in kingdom language, the kingdom is the glory of the king. It is the evidence of their power, their rule, their authority, their wisdom, and the goodness, the flowing benefit to all within the kingdom, all of, you know, to use medieval language, the subjects of the land or the people of the kingdom. So we have both ideas here, the glory of God and the holiness of God, beginning our prayer by centering on who God is, that we are talking to the Holy One who is different from anyone else. This should be while we use simple human words. We don't need big, flowery, special words in order to have the privilege of talking to God. And yet, we are not talking to God in the same exact way that we would talk to anybody else. There is a recognition, not that we need different words, but that God is uniquely different than anyone else that we could speak to. So it's important for us to acknowledge God's holiness, his purity, his excellence, and his glory, his majesty, if you would, his power and authority, who he is. Well, let's go just a little bit further into this kind of list of a few things. And in our dependence on God, we acknowledge who he is, his power, his majesty, his glory, but we also acknowledge his hand, what he has done, his graciousness, his loving kindness, his gentleness, his humility to interact with mankind. And the God of the Bible, the God that we believe in, is very unique in any other religious idea of human history, in his tenderness, his personalness, his willingness to condescend or come down and communicate, interact on our level of understanding for our benefit. And so I want to highlight here just a few elements that he mentions of areas of life that we are dependent upon him and that we can have a certain confidence or boldness in when we pray, that these are areas in which God is gracious and gives. He gifts us. He blesses us. He takes care of us in these areas, and we are dependent on that kindness, that grace, in order to grow, in order to receive what it is that we need to be the people he desires of us. So the language here, one, is bread. We read in verse 3, give us each day our daily bread. And bread here, especially culturally speaking in its time, it's speaking to our daily needs, what we need to exist, what we need for physical sustenance, and to what we have to have in order to survive, to be people. I love that it says our daily bread. And I was talking to Merritt the other day and asking him if he had had any aha moments in his studies or things that he's heard about the Sermon on the Mount. And he mentioned this particular one, and I appreciated it, so I want to share it with you. This idea of daily bread, that God gives us what is sufficient for right now, for this thing that we're going through, for this day, for this moment. I likened it to the principles that we see in the Old Testament as God gave the gift of manna to the children of Israel as they were wandering during the time of Exodus out in the wilderness, out in the desert region. The principle of the manna, he had given them instruction to only glean what they needed for that day, and that the next day more would be there. But they had to take that on faith, that God would be enough, that he would be gracious enough to provide again the next day, and then again the next day, and then again the next day. And then on Friday, they were supposed to collect enough for that day and the Sabbath. And it was the only day that God would miraculously allow the manna to be preserved, to last. Any other day, if they had collected extra, we're told that at the end of the day, it would putrefy. It would go bad and would not be useful for food at all. But this principle of manna, that God gives us each day what is sufficient for that day. In other places of Scripture, in the Psalms, it teaches us that, that God's grace is new every day. Morning. His mercy is new every morning, that he abundantly gives to us that which we need in that time. So our daily needs. The next part here is there's a request to forgive us our sins. Now, forgiveness, there are many other spiritual needs that we could talk about. We need God's atonement and making us right with the Father. We need transformation and newness of thought and heart and spiritual life. There's many other spiritual things that we need from God. But at its core, our essential spiritual need is for forgiveness, for that which has separated us from God, our sin, to be cleansed, to be washed away, to be forgiven by God, so that right relationship can be built from that point on. So when it says to request of God, forgive us our sins, it's speaking to our most essential spiritual needs, that we trust God for these things, and it is appropriate. We have been invited to ask him for this. He delights, in other words, in providing forgiveness, in providing those essential spiritual needs for his children. Now, there's a second component to that element there in verse 4, which is our last point here on the slide. It reads, for ourselves, also forgive everyone who is indebted to us. We are invited to be a part of that process of forgiving others as well. So as we are receiving and learning forgiveness for ourselves and what that does in our life and how good that is and feels, the freedom of that, we are learning to treat others in the same way. Then it moves on, the end of verse 4, it says, and lead us not into temptation. Oh, I wish I had more time to really dive into this particular point. It's really a whole nother sermon, a whole nother teaching of its own, of the depths of what does this mean to seek God, to lead us not in temptation. The core idea here is the idea of protection, that God is the one who gives us strength and power, who gives us spiritual newness and awareness of mind, not to be duped into the traps and the allurements of sin and the temptations of the evil one in our life, gives us discernment, the presence of the Holy Spirit to discern the motives behind things and the difference between right and wrong and longer-term spiritual connotations of our choices. God is the one who aids us, who gives us sound counsel and direction and help in understanding these things. We need him. We lean on him for protection of our soul. We're told that God is able to keep us from sin. Now, personally, I would interpret that is a partnership that is taking place, that God does all of his part, as I've already described, in providing understanding, in awakening us, in being there in the presence of his Holy Spirit, in providing conviction for us, in providing a new way of looking at things, a new worldview to interpret and understand. He brings back to our minds our previous experience. I don't know about you, but there's been times in my life where I've had repeated sins, and part of what God uses to help me break those habits and find freedom over those sins is in that moment where there's temptation, there is also the grace of God through his Holy Spirit bringing back the memory of the destruction and the pain and the entrapment that sin has brought in the past, and not wanting to go back to that place again. So God is able to protect us, to guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And it is appropriate for us to regularly be praying to him and requesting that help. It isn't because God is resisting or withholding that help. And so, unless you ask, you're not allowed to have that help. That's not what's being taught here, I don't believe. Instead, God is inviting us to be aware, to grow in our faith and trust and understanding that we need the interaction with the Lord. We need his protective hand. It's a way of, again, acknowledging his holiness, his glory, his loving kindness toward us. Well, let's keep moving on to our next passage, which is just a few verses down here, picking up again in verse 9 of chapter 11. Feel free to go back and read verses 5 through 8. There's a good analogy there of a person who's being petitioned or being requested by their friend for help. There's a great analogy there, but we're going to get another one of those later on, and so we'll come back to it. In verse 9, we pick up with the core principle coming off of that analogy that Jesus teaches. So reading verses 9 through 13 here of chapter 11 says, "So I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. Now suppose one of you fathers is asked by his son for a fish. He will not give him a snake instead of a fish, will he? Or if he asked for an egg, He will not give him a scorpion, will he? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Okay, so we get this principle stemming off the previous analogy, and then we get a second word picture given to us, that of the good Father. So let's take a look at this briefly. Our main principle is that we are to pray with faith in God. We are to trust him and his character that we were just talking about. We need to lean into that. We need to trust him in that. Well, let's look first at this principle that we're given, particularly verses 9 and 10 here. It gives us a list of three things: to ask, to seek, and to knock. Now, these are word pictures. These are descriptive ways to put into human language, to personify in actions the behind-the-scenes nature of how we interact with God in prayer. Now, it is not true that the only things we ever do is ask God for stuff. That is not the summation of prayer. But it is talking about this faith element. The first one here is to ask, to make requests, to make our hearts known to God, to ask for what it is that we believe we need. Now, if we were to take a broader look on prayer and look at other passages about prayer, we would learn that the prayer principle, that when we are to pray, we aren't to pray just in our own selfish desire. It isn't that we're just supposed to ask for anything and everything that we want. Even though the door is open, the attitude and motive behind those requests do matter. So we are to pray in the Spirit of God. We are to pray according to that which we know already is of value and importance to God. So when we ask in a way that is connecting with the nature of God, connecting to the priorities that he's already expressed to us in Scripture, which is where one of many reasons why good Bible study is so valuable, to learn the history and the revealed evidence of what matters to God. What is his heart? What does he value? How has he interacted with mankind in the past and shown his heart to us is so important. So that when we come and we ask, we have confidence that it is in alignment with God's own heart. And when we ask, we can trust that God hears that request and that he sees it in the context of what he knows to be best from us. He's the one who can see the future. He's the one who intimately knows our past. He's the one who knows everything about our individual makeup, our personality, our weaknesses, our strengths, our current depth of relationship or maturity in relationship with him. He knows the right timing for us for things. And so we can trust his answer when he asks for things is for our good and for the good of his kingdom. Nothing is going to be out of balance. He's not going to give us something for our destruction. The next one is to seek. And I'm going to go simpler and faster with this. The idea is to seek after him. Out of Matthew and the Sermon on the Mount, and as we sang already this morning, he teaches us to seek him first and the kingdom of God. And anything else that we would need He would provide for us. We can trust Him in when our motive, when our first heart response is to seek Him, to seek His desire, His will, His understanding, His way in things. Again, another reason why knowing the Scripture is so important, that we would have right understanding and right interpretation there. The last one is to knock, and it's calling us to visualize a literal knocking on the door. Again, it follows so closely after this idea of seeking. This knocking, and you see it in the analogy just before this that we didn't read, but you're going to see it here in just a moment when we go to our next passage. The idea of pounding on the door repeatedly, getting God's attention. Now, it is not true that we need to get God's attention because He's not paying attention, but He's helping us to understand in human terms that prayer is much like knocking on a door and making ourselves known, making our requests known, and that's appropriate. It's okay to pound on the door of God and lay out our passions, lay out our needs, lay out the concerns of our heart before Him. He invites us to do that. So He says, ask, seek, and knock. And there is a type of promise here. He is likening it to that when we do these things in the normal natural world, we expect some sort of result to come from it. And likewise here in the spiritual sense, in petitioning and interacting with God our Father, it is okay for us to expect result. It is not necessarily okay for us to expect that result is going to be exactly what we, in our limited view, in our limited understanding and ability as a human being, would interpret or would desire. God has full freedom to answer in such a way that is deeper and more profound and better than what we would understand or imagine, even if that betterness hurts first, even if it doesn't feel like a good thing that we would naturally interpret as a good, we are to trust God that it is for the greater good of what He understands. Well, let's keep moving down to verses 11 through 13. We get this great word picture and this great analogy comparison of the good Father. Verses 11 through 13, he asked it in the form of questions, which was such a classic style for rabbis of the day. He's asking wisdom questions. So which one of you fathers, if you're a dad, now this works just fine for if you're a mom as well, but in their context, if you're a father and your child comes to you asking for a basic need, asking for food, asking for something that they need and would desire. If they come asking for a fish, who would give them something dangerous, destructive, completely different, like a snake? These are not interchangeable in their world view as far as food or value or necessity. Who would do that? Or if your child comes and asks for an egg, something to eat, right? Who would give them a scorpion, something dangerous, something destructive instead? And he follows that up with then the heart question, which is, okay, if you as human beings who are fallible, who are flawed because of sin, he uses the term evil. If you being evil, meaning, he's not trying to be mean and call people names here. He's meaning from a theological standpoint, in comparison to God, we have been infected with sin. And he's saying, if even sinful people, even people who don't believe in God yet or haven't been cleansed, who might not even have good motives or even good relationships with their children all the time, if you know how to give good gifts, then how much more confident should the believer be in their Heavenly Father that He is exponentially better and more good than we would be, that He is longing to show kindness and generosity and grace towards His children? It's a wonderful question, and we're going to have another one like it here when we get into our third section that's going to challenge us. It's a good heart question for us to wrestle with of, is there faith in the Lord when we're praying? That's not the same thing as manipulating and demanding God do exactly what we want Him to do and that we get these results and that we get it right now. It's a different heart that says, God, You've invited me to share my life, to share my soul, to share my heart with You, and I'm going to trust that You're going to carry something good, something right out from this. Well, down just the tail end of that last verse in 13 there, we get the idea that the Holy Spirit is involved. And so we want us to see the Holy Spirit here as gift and guide. And there's a couple other passages that I want to invite us to take a very quick look at. The Holy Spirit is a gift and a guide. Verse 13b. Well, I'm going to read all of verse 13, then we'll zero in on the last phrase here. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask Him? The gift here that is raised above any other, there's so many other things that Jesus could have said God would give as a gift, but raised, elevated above any other that He could come up with, He says the Holy Spirit is the gift that God is giving to us. Now, what is the role of the Holy Spirit in prayer? And it's going to take me a second because I didn't mark them ahead of time, but I want to pop over to these two is all we're going to have time for right now, but two passages that talk about that a little bit more. First one being in 1 Corinthians. Sorry, I'm turning over there myself real quick. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 10 through 11, if you would, reads, "For to us God revealed them through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, even the depths of God. For who among men knows the thoughts of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, the thoughts of God no one knows except the Spirit of God." One of the roles of the Holy Spirit is to be this liaison, that the Holy Spirit resides with the believer, but intimately knows the mind of God, is God present with us. So while we may not always have understanding, the Holy Spirit present with us is able to search the mind and the heart of God, as well as our hearts and minds, and create this spiritual connection between us. There's something similar over in Romans 8:26 that goes a little bit further. So let's turn back to the book of Romans here. Take me just a moment. Romans 8, verse 26 is probably pretty familiar to us. It reads, "In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we should. but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. I love this passage. I've leaned on this passage so many times. Oftentimes, just in our humanity and where we usually are, our prayers are usually thoughts. They're words, especially in a corporate setting. We actually think through words. We may even be voicing them out loud. When we're praying at home and on our own, it's probably a mix of thought through words as well as images or even feelings, expressions that just come to our mind as we're praying. It's probably a combination of the two. And I think this passage goes even further. There are times and there is a depth that we may not totally understand in which the Holy Spirit is interacting with us in prayer. Now, we more readily recognize when the Holy Spirit brings passages of Scripture to mind as we're praying, or brings a sense of conviction to mind in prayer, or principles of Scripture that we understand. These are ways in which God one place in Scripture talks about that the Holy Spirit's role is to remind us of all truth and that to convince us that we are children of God, to remind us that we are His children. These are ways that He's interacting and helping us to glean and understand and be connected and see the truth as we're praying. But there's also a way in which we're told here that as the Holy Spirit searches our hearts, knows our motives, knows who we are, that He is, much like Jesus is described, as an advocate before the Father in regard to defense of sin in our lives and speaking on our behalf of our sinfulness, the Holy Spirit also communicates with the whole of God the depths beyond what we may even be able to bring to mind. Especially, I think, of times of challenge or anguish or grief that sometimes goes beyond our words, goes beyond our mind's ability to process and to communicate. The Holy Spirit communicates with God the Father as we are honest, as we are seeking Him, as we are praying and doing our very best in seeking Him out. He communicates at a level deeper than what we maybe even be able to communicate to another person. I think that's a powerful passage. This idea of that Jesus, that the Father gives the Holy Spirit as our gift, and that the Holy Spirit in turn has a vital role in our prayer. Well, the last little bit in this section that I want to bring up is an interesting idea, and it's brought out actually in your leadership guides if you're following along, and I thought it was kind of cool, so I want to talk about it just briefly, which is the idea of prayer and providence. Providence being the idea of that God's will is being carried out. It connects to the idea of God's sovereignty, and providence is that God's will is being carried out the way that He wants it to be, and especially it speaks to the interaction points, the intersection points with our lives. So God's will is being carried out, and that means that we get to be a part of that, or there can be good for us along the way. That when we pray, and especially in requests or in sharing our concerns and our longings, the things that are outside of our control, the understanding that God is going to do the right thing. Well, if God is going to do the right thing, if he is sovereign, if he already has a determined will, then why are we praying? Why do we have to ask God for things? Or why is that important? There seems to be almost a paradox between these two things, between the invitation to pray and yet God's providence or his already determined, his choice of will of what he wants to do. So why is prayer important? There's a number of good answers to this, and scholars and good Christian followers, God seekers, and people of depth have really explored this over the years, and there's lots of good things out there. There is a both and. We have been invited to engage in prayer, and there's some interesting places in Scripture about this that I want to be careful with. There are some places that seem to indicate of God reserving his choice in certain areas until we partner with him in prayer. But beyond that, I think at its core, God invites us to interact with him through prayer, to become partners, to gain awareness with what it is that he desires and what he is doing. It is reminder for us, and it is practice for us to take our thoughts and our motives captive, to come into alignment with him. It may be in many instances that God is going to do something no matter what. It's impossible for you and I to see that ahead of time and know that outside of what he has already revealed in his word. For instance, we know some things about eschatology, end times, how God is planning to end things. We know that he desires for people to be saved. And so he will forgive because he's already promised us that he will forgive when we seek his forgiveness, when we repent and turn from our evil ways. So those are things that we have confidence in his providence because he's already revealed it to us. But in so many areas, we don't know what God's specific will is. He hasn't revealed it in Scripture to us about choices we might make or things going on in the world and how some detail situation is going to turn out one way or another, or you know, what our next job's going to be, and all these kinds of things. And so when we pray, yes, we may be asking him for things, but it may not be that he is going to give us an answer right now to our question or to our desire, but it may be more the importance of the prayer is for us coming into alignment with his character, with his value set, and humbling ourselves, becoming submissive to him, that whatever he would decide, however it is that he answers in his time, that we would be ready for and willing to obey in. God is the one who is sovereign. He's the one that gets to make the decisions. Prayer is still important because he has given it to us as a gift and invited us to be engaged with him. And so often it is more about our benefit in the prayer than it is, you know, talking God into something or convincing him of our point of view. Well, let's go to this last part. It's from Luke chapter 18, if you want to flip over there with me real quick. There's a cool parable, an interesting parable, an atypical prayer parable in my perspective, one that challenges my thinking, because Jesus uses a bad guy as our example. And I'm not being too judgmental there. And yes, there's a little bit of a play on words, but let's look at this bad guy together. Chapter 18, starting in verse 1, first 8 verses here. says, now he was, and this is Jesus, now he was telling them a parable to show that at all times they ought to pray and not to lose heart, saying, in a certain city there was a judge who did not fear God and did not respect man. There was a widow in that city, and she kept coming to him, saying, give me legal protection from my opponent. For a while he was unwilling, but afterward he said to himself, even though I do not fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow bothers me, I will give her legal protection. Otherwise, by continually coming, she will wear me out. And the Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge said. Now will not God bring about justice for his elect, and who cry to him day and night? And will he delay long over them? I tell you that he will bring about justice for them quickly. However, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? It's the parable of the unjust or the unrighteous judge. And I think that's so interesting that, again, it's kind of like he did in our previous passage where he says, if you who are sinful, if you who are infected by sin, are willing to do good things. In this case, if he's using the worst case scenario picture, this incongruent picture of here's someone who's been put in the position of being a judge, the one who is supposed to preserve and offer justice for individuals, but this particular individual doesn't have any principles, doesn't have any values that are right, doesn't fear God, doesn't respect or care about the affairs of man, doesn't really care about justice. It's the wrong person in the wrong role. And this person ends up doing the right thing or providing justice, but not from the right heart because they don't have a right heart. And so then we're asked the question again, much like our previous passage, of if that's what if that's what the wrong kind of person would do, how much more would God, who is just, who does care, who does look for your good, how much more would he be willing to be just, to seek out what is good, what is right for us? We're told, and I love this, right away in verse 1, we're given what the point of the parable is. I love when Jesus does this and we don't have to guess. We're told that the whole point of this section right here, what we're being taught, is to not lose heart. And that's our principle here. It's persistence. We're to pray with persistence to God. We're not to lose heart. Now, that might seem strange in some ways of, you know, I don't want to bother God. He's so important. He has so many things to do. Maybe my issue I don't see as big or important as somebody else's issue or the issues in the world. And God says, no, I invite you, be like someone who is seeking justice. When something is right, when you know it's in alignment with God's heart, when it's the difference between right and wrong, when it's a moral issue, God encourages us to be tenacious, to stick with it, to hunger for justice, for righteousness long term. We don't know all the reasons why God might, it might seem like things are happening slowly on our end. We don't know how many hearts he's having to interact with or what he's having to change or how many opportunities it's going to take for someone to repent and turn or all these so many variables that are outside of our understanding and ability to see. God does, and he desires our patience, but also that we not let go of the issue. If it's important that we remain passionate, that we continue to seek. Much like this woman sought justice from this judge. And I don't think what God is saying is, I'm going to answer you because you wear me out. That's not what he's saying. He's making a comparison of character of if this judge who only does the right thing for the wrong reasons is nonetheless comes to the right position, how much more can we trust our judge, our advocate, our one who has the authority, who has all the right motives and all the right reasons and does care? Ends with a very challenging question, and I want to wrap up with this and just a concluding thought and prayer. This challenging question at the end, when the Son of Man comes. Now remember, this is Jesus saying this. He's referring to his second coming. When the Son of Man comes, or you might read in, comes again, will he find faith on the earth? I find this interesting because I believe that Jesus standing there that day already had the ability to look ahead. He knows what the scenario is going to look like when he returns. That's what I personally believe. But it's a wonderful food for thought question for us to be provoked. Will we be persistent now, not just in prayer, but in faith overall? When Jesus comes, will he find righteousness? Will he find faith? Will he find a remnant who have been faithful to look and to be attentive, to be alert, hungering for his return? Have we been faithful to the call that he has put on our lives? Have we been faithful to be his ambassadors, his representatives in his type of absence that there has been? Have we been mindful of our own hearts, our own relationship? Have we been diligent to grow? Going back to the parable of the servants who invest the talents, have we been investing the faith and the relationship that God has given to us in others, that there might be dividends, that there might be growth given back to the Father? What are we doing with the relationship that God has given us? Are we being faithful in prayer? Are we growing? Are we asking him in a way that connects with God's heart? Are we seeking after the character and the relationship and the presence of God in our lives? Are we tenacious? Are we pounding on the door, seeking for justice, for righteousness, for God's good in the world? And are we willing to be the agents? Are we willing to, some of our of the old timers used to talk about becoming the answer to our prayers, not out of our own power, but in receiving this, God being able to pour his passion and his burden into us in such a way that we become active and involved in his, as his hands and feet of answering the prayers, the needs, the concerns of the world. Three principles for us to learn here in prayer: to pray with dependence on God, to pray with faith in God, and to pray with persistence to God. All things that Jesus taught us. Wrapping up here, we have this missional statement. So how do these things, how does our engagement with prayer, how should that affect then our mission to go out and make disciples, to reach the world for Christ? Read it this way: because we have access to the Father through Christ, that's the prayer connection, because we have access directly to him, we pray earnestly for the salvation of those around us as we share the gospel with them. one part of our prayer should be what is called intercessory prayer, or lifting others up before the Lord, especially, and that can be for any area of life, but especially for the purpose of their salvation, the tenderness and awareness of their spirit, that they would be open to the Lord. Well, thank you for joining me this morning. Let's wrap up with prayer to the Lord and contemplating how we're going to apply these things, and then we'll close with a song at the end. Lord, thank you for what may be in some ways simple teaching, but yet teaching of depth and profoundness that you gave us. God, it's truly amazing. Maybe at this point and where we're at in history, maybe we take it for granted, this gift of prayer, and that we can simply talk to you. But how powerful, how important that is. Thank you, Lord, that you have invited us to interact with you in this way, that you are constantly open all the time to hear from us, to know our hearts, to interact with us, and to bring peace, to give guidance to our spirits, to check us and align us with your own values and your own heart. Help us to listen to your word and listen to your spirit as we pray, even though we may not always get some direct, clear word type answer, as you bring up the truth of Scripture to us, as you guide us into truth and righteousness. May we determine in ourselves to be obedient to you, to follow the revelation that you have given us. Thank you, Lord. We love you so much, and I pray that you would use us to be a blessing, an encouragement, and an instigator in this world, that they might see you and know you and follow after you. We love you, Lord. May you bless each one today as they go in faith and grace. May they be enriched in their prayer life with you, that they might grow deep roots into and deep wells of faith. We love you, Lord. In your name, amen.
Let us sing the doxology together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
God bless you.